Thank you for being here. And you were telling me how Ted Turner, speaking of, was in your office in the 70s pitching a cable news network.
Exactly. He was a revolutionary on nuclear proliferation, on the environment, and on communications, all in one man.
Right.
You know, just an incredible guy.
Well, I'm proud to work for those three letters that he founded. And it's proud to be here with you, gentlemen. These are interesting times. Let me start with the news of the day, since we have you here. And greetings to all of our CNN citizen audience members who are watching this streaming live. But history was made today. You helped that happen. The confirmation of now Justice Ketanji Brown Jackson. Sure. I think I did the math. I think in the history of the Supreme Court, 94% are older white guys. So this is a seismic moment that we may take for granted in ways when it's going by. What was it like, Senator?
Times are changing, though. It was a historic moment.
Yeah.
And it was interesting. I don't think I've ever seen so many House members come into the Senate chamber, and they were all seated around the edge. And just the sense of history in that moment was very palpable.
Yeah. She will join a court that is entering the climate age of jurisprudence. The court, she won't be part of the case, but they heard West Virginia versus the EPA, depending, you know, they'll decide whether or not an agency can regulate climate cooking pollution. There's 20 different states, cities suing big oil, trying to get some sense of damages for what they say were lies told. What do you see happening in the courts, Senator Markey, when it comes to climate? Is that going to happen sooner than legislation can happen in a meaningful way?
Well, it was a powerful day. Martin and I were honored to be there, to be able to cast a vote to have Ketanji Brown Jackson be elevated to the Supreme Court of the United States. And, you know, standing behind us were a high percentage of all of the African-American congresswomen applauding loudly. But then even above us, up in the galleries, was packed with young African-American men and women and Latinos and Asians and young white activists all applauding and cheering at this great moment. And they have a reason to be hopeful, optimistic, because she is a potential historic change agent, the same way that Thurgood Marshall was. The most important environmental decision of all time was Massachusetts versus the EPA. In April of 2007, that decision, 5-4, with Justice Scalia writing the dissent, but by 5-4, it ordered the EPA to make a determination as to whether or not greenhouse gases were endangering our country, our planet. And if they determined it was endangering, then they had to take action. Well, obviously, that was a turning point because it allowed Barack Obama to increase fuel economy standards. It allowed Barack Obama to put controls on the emissions coming out of power plants generated by coal and natural gas. So the Republicans are now hopeful that this Supreme Court, 6-3, with two of the seats that were stolen, will now overturn that decision, will modify it in a way that we won't have that historic progress which the Supreme Court said that the EPA must try to enact. So we are at a pivotal point, but we're very fortunate that Ketanji Brown Jackson will now be on the Supreme Court so she can explain to the other justices the impact that their decision could have on black and brown and indigenous and immigrant communities in our country, and that we needed and that we need environmental justice for everyone. So from my perspective, yes, the courts are very important, but the Congress is as well, and Martin and I are committed to passing a comprehensive and historic climate bill this year so that we put the pieces in place to create a revolution that can save our country and the planet.
I would be remiss as a journalist without pointing out a big part of the story today, though, was your colleagues on the other side of the aisle, vast majority choosing not to celebrate in that moment and seeming to walk out as a sign of protest, Mitt Romney the exception. I set that up just in terms of the Build Back Better plan, and we're talking about climate legislation right now. and how divisive the partisan politics has gotten. But it seems that maybe Joe Manchin is the, I don't know if it's Joe Manchin or President Xi of China who has more power over sort of the immediate future of where we go as a species. Where are we? What is happening with all the promises made? And is there going to be meaningful climate legislation this year?
I think I'm more dramatically more optimistic than I was, obviously, over the Christmas and New Year's holidays when things really came apart. The surprising thing about the entire effort to get a reconciliation bill done this year was not actually the climate pieces that things kind of fell apart around. A lot of the climate pieces actually came through the Energy and Natural Resources Committee, which is Joe's committee. A lot of the other pieces come out of the Finance Committee because they're incentives, they're tax incentives largely. So we're certainly not hovering near 100%, but I think we're well above 50% that we can get something together that will be maybe not as expansive as many of us had hoped, but deeply meaningful on climate and really continuing to grow entire industries that have been stood up in the last decade.
Right. Pivoting to the other big topic, we've gotten a couple questions on the relation of the war in Ukraine, Putin's invasion, what that does to energy markets, the need to decarbonize at the same time there's a crunch. I know you have sort of an electrify for peace idea, and you're both into the heat pump. You know, it's about efficiency, it's about new ways of thinking around this. I remember, you know, in my history classes, there was a poster in World War II that had it was like a cartoon that says, when you ride alone, you ride with Hitler, in order to get people to carpool and think about energy use in a different way. Senator Markey, do you see this, what may be a protracted war in Europe, as a turning point for whether we go electric or whether people double down on the old familiar fossil fuels?
Well, I think it's very clear over the last 6 weeks that our addiction to oil is a conduit for conflict. Yeah. And the Green New Deal is a pathway to peace. And if we put in place policies with wind and solar and all electric vehicles and battery storage technologies and all these clean energy technologies, in a very brief period of time, we're going to see a revolution. So for example, with every 15 million all electric vehicles that we deploy in the United States, it backs out all of the Russian oil. The next 15 million all electric vehicles would back up all the Saudi oil, et cetera, et cetera. Just to back out the Russian oil, if in 500 days we deployed 5 million all-electric vehicles, 5 million heat pumps, 500,000 all-electric buses, we back out all the Russian oil. And if we pass the package that Martin and I support for $555 billion, then that revolution will happen very, very rapidly. So that's our challenge as a people. Do we want to take Putin, use him as the example of what happens when you become too dependent upon fossil fuels, and act? And I believe that that is going to be clear to the American people when our bill is finally brought out to the floor of the United States Senate, that the only way to vote for future, for peace, and for justice is to vote for clean energy.
Senator Heinrich, is motivation of your pocketbook, you know, politics, when you're looking at the mm-hmm. price of gas, those sorts of things, is how does, you know, going green benefit me financially? Is that more powerful than patriotism? And in order to beat Putin, you got to, you know, wear a sweater and conserve?
Well, I think this is a case where you don't have to choose because they align. Yeah. And we have technologies that we didn't, you know, you talk about heat pumps. They weren't quite ready for prime time 10 years ago, but today they are. And, you know, we were arguing about efficiency 10 years ago. You know, could you get a gas furnace to be 90% efficient? Well, a heat pump is 300% efficient because it doesn't actually make heat. It moves heat, which means you can cool with it in the other season too.
Right.
So all of these technologies, because they're so efficient and because they insulate you from the crazy roller coaster of commodity prices, right? Gas prices, fossil gas prices went up double this year. Gas prices went to, you know, $5 a gallon in many places. We're actually doing the right thing patriotically, but in the long run, it's going to save people a lot of money, and that's important too.
The someone who was asking very specifically, what is the role of the Build Back Better plan in creating climate solutions? I didn't get a name, good question. But is it that it will tip the market to a point where these things become more, the greener choice is the smarter choice financially that way? But at the same time, we can't even get the postal fleet to go electric due to politics in Washington. So how will the Build Back Better plan advance this?
For 100 years, the oil and gas industry have had tax breaks from the American people. Now, when we talk about tax breaks for our technologies, they call it socialism. And all we're saying is, if you had tax breaks for 100 years for fossil fuels, give us some of that socialism for wind and solar and all electric vehicles and batteries, and we will bury that industry, you know, in a generation. And we will deploy the all-electric vehicles, we'll deploy the batteries, the wind, the solar. But we need those tax breaks on the books so that it's affordable in the near term for people to purchase those all-electric vehicles, so that the wind and solar is deployed at a much more rapid rate than it is right now. And the faster we do it, is the lower the cost will be. And that revolution will happen very, very rapidly. So we could do 50% of all new vehicles by the year 2030, if this bill passes. We could have 40 to 50% of our electricity generated from non-greenhouse gas-emitting sources by 2030. It will all happen if this piece of legislation passes. We'll create millions of new jobs, union jobs. We'll have environmental justice, finally, in our country. And we will, in the bargain, be saving not only our own country, but the planet from the dangerous consequences of climate change.
Matthew and PJ came together on this question. In your view, what role does nuclear energy play in solving the climate crisis, and what can be done to ensure that we can safely dispose of nuclear waste so it doesn't harm marginalized communities?
The role of nuclear today, one of the things that we can do to, and it's really about accelerating this transition. That's why those tax incentives are so important. We're going to win this war, but we don't have a lot of time on our side. And so making sure that we get all of our energy without carbon pollution as quickly as possible, it really matters how you do that.
So the knock against nuclear is it takes too long to build a plant?
Well, I think that the what we really need to do is take our existing nuclear fleet and operate it for as long as we can operate it safely. That's really key because it provides some of the kind of power that we're right now relying far too much on coal. As we dramatically add renewables to the mix, add storage to be able to buffer things in different time frames. I don't think we'll ever see another big plant like that built because the cost challenges for that kind of nuclear are substantial, but I do think you're going to see small modular nuclear reactors be part of that long-term solution. And then when it comes to all things waste, ideally you would turn waste back into fuel. And if you have to do long-term storage, you actually need to do it with the consent of the state, the community, the places where you would do that.
Right, right. Covering this beat, it's easy to go deep into dark holes and look at the latest science and the warnings and the evidence right in front of us. And when I'm feeling down, I go to the other file, which is all these amazing ideas from nuclear fusion, the next generation, not fission, but fusion, right. Which is the power of the sun in a box, but safe enough to blow out like a match, and all these moonshot ideas. But in your state, we're just now sort of starting to catch up with Europe in the early days when it comes to wind. There was a huge lease sale offshore. I've been telling people we're sort of on the cutting edge of a huge boom of offshore wind. What do you say, Senator Markey?
Well, you're right. The same winds that blew the pilgrims to the shores of Plymouth, the same winds that had Herman Melville poetic about whaling off of the New England coast, it's the same wind that can power our homes and our industries for the next generation. And the Biden administration has done a great job. They're targeting 30,000 megawatts of power off of our East Coast. And in Massachusetts, we've already begun with the first 800 megawatts, which will create thousands of new jobs. And the beauty of this is that we can bring it in very easily into our economy. It doesn't pollute. There are no meltdowns. And it's actually ultimately going to be cheaper than the historic fossil fuel generation of electricity. So we're very optimistic about this. So, for example, the Pilgrim nuclear power plant or the Seabrook nuclear power plant in Massachusetts and New Hampshire is about 1,000 megawatts. We're talking 30,000 megawatts
right.
of wind.
Yeah.
So when people think about the scale, it's there. And the same thing, by the way, is true for wind as well. Right now in Massachusetts, we generate 16% of all of our electricity from renewables. 14% of all of our electricity in Massachusetts is from solar. We're not the perfectly sunny state.
Yeah, you're far from the Sun Belt.
The technologies have become more efficient, deployable, and utilities feel pressure to move in that direction because it's the most cost-effective way of generating new sources of electricity. And we're enthusiastic about it in New England, and we're thinking about raising our goals that much more because of Ukraine. Because of what's happening, we have to lift our gaze to the constellation of possibilities in the deployment of these energy technologies in a way that we never have before.
I think a lot of people think, Senator, that you know when you use one product to fuel your life, your whole life, gasoline, you pour it in a tank, and it's just you change the shape of the thing that burns the gasoline. You tend to think in terms of, well, what's going to be the one thing that replaces this? We know we have to. But the more I'm in this space, the more I realize it's not a bullet, it's buckshot. It's 100 different things.
Exactly right.
It's a heat pump and a few solar panels, but you don't need a lot of them because your house is so sealed tight that, you know, your utility bill is $3 and you're powering your car off of the, you know, all
Absolutely.
Of that together times 350 million, right?
That's exactly right. We have a colleague who actually says often, it's not a silver bullet, but it is silver buckshot. Meaning we have to take all of these solutions together and then rapidly deploy them. And it is the kind of homes you build. It's how we swap out the appliances in those homes. You know, a lot of the emissions that we have are associated with gas stoves, gas hot water heaters, things we never really thought about even a few years ago. Now we understand that those are bad for the climate. They're also bad for indoor air quality, really bad.
Yeah.
And creating, we now have the technology to swap that stuff out, but you have to initially levelize the economics so that it makes sense for somebody who's, you know, got the in-laws over and suddenly the hot water heater breaks. You want it at the same price. You don't want to have to wait for a tax credit. You want it at the point of sale. And then we'll really rapidly be able to accelerate these changes that will permeate everything and give us a much better, cleaner world for our kids.
Let me ask this. Just from a pure political point of view, because we see this, that states like California or cities, even like Austin and Texas, want to eliminate new construction with natural gas, for example. Just we got to get away from natural gas. But then you've got conservative state legislatures or governors banning bans on gas. And it's creating this, what I'm afraid of is we're going to end up as the energy Balkans, where you can go to a clean state like Massachusetts, but it doesn't, in the grand scheme of things, you know, matter to the big fight because we need to all do this at the same time. How does, at the Senate level, do you deal with something when all zoning is local?
We need to actually overhaul the way in which we view, for example, the transmission of electricity in our country. We need a new deal for the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission. It has historically just been too much controlled in a vise-like grip by the traditional utilities, the natural gas and coal industries. So we have to change the way in which we do business because we can bring the wind off of the ocean. We can bring the sun off of the prairies or the desert and transmit it into the cities where the populations are. And we can do it very rapidly if we change the rules, if we change the way in which we do business. And that's our challenge in this generation, because the utilities are going to fight it. They like their monopolies. They like the way they do business. But it's all there. And if we marry up all of that wind and solar that's all across our country, the geothermal as well, I might add, and find a way of getting it into where the population centers are, then that revolution will happen in the blink of a historic eye. And all it takes is for the House and the Senate to pass the legislation that will make it possible for that revolution to be unleashed.
What has to happen for that to happen when it comes specifically to Senator Manchin?
We, you know, I think we're all continuing to talk with Senator Manchin, and certainly he has some, has been supportive of a number of these things, including the things that came out of his own committee for reconciliation. So I think there is a path there. I'm certainly not going to try to speak for Senator Manchin. And then to your earlier question about the balkanization, then the culture wars are real. But once we use a bill like this to win the economic war, once that power is cheaper and easier for every consumer, then you've really won the war. Then things move on their own without policy. And that's what a lot of the things that are inside Build Back Better and reconciliation are about, winning that economic war, accelerating what we're already doing that we would normally be content to wait decades for this stuff to play out. We don't have decades. We have to do it now.
Yeah, there's a good reason why utility executives don't order new nuclear power plants, order new coal burning plants, because they're not economic any longer. As the price of wind and solar continues to collapse, you'll be fired on the board of an electric utility if you purchase the higher cost way to generate electricity in our country. So we're winning the economics. And ultimately, as each year goes by and there are more employees out there working around these industries, the political power will eventually just break down that wall of opposition that has existed over the decades to this clean energy revolution.
There is a lot of obvious resistance from the entrenched industries. Do you see that conversation changing when it comes to social license? That, you know, it's hard to see an oil company ad with an oil pump in it anymore. It's all solar panels.
They want to tell you about all the great things that they're doing that they're spending 0.01% of their CapEx on.
Exactly.
But it is absolutely this rising generation that is changing the social license and changing it faster than I've seen in any transition, social or otherwise. And you know, that is going to have a giant impact on what the world of the possible looks like. It, you know, we tend to, in the United States, it might have been Churchill who said, like, we always get it right. It's just you get it wrong until you get it right.
After you've exhausted all other options, exactly. Americans usually do the right thing.
When we make these changes, it's going to be all in. And I think we will see the pace of change moves so quickly that it's going to be quite shocking to a lot of people, but almost all on the upside. Not everything, but almost all on the upside.
I'm stealing this from a climate scientist I appreciate and follow on Twitter, who said, you know, what gives you hope? And for him, he's like, the fact that we haven't even started trying yet. You know, we haven't even scratched the surface of what is possible in this new age. But finally, as we wind down this, Senator, you've been in Congress since Jimmy Carter was trying to put solar panels on the White House. How has the climate conversation evolved in your career, and where are we now?
Well, it's changed in this way. When people ask me, what's the difference between 2009 and 2010, when Henry Waxman and I were passing the Waxman-Markey bill that would have reduced greenhouse gases by 80% by the year 2050, which was ultimately defeated in the Senate, and today. Well, the biggest difference is this, that there's now a movement out there. Young people, age 18, 25, 30, 35, they want action. They believe that the preceding generations have let them down. So this is now a issue that has captured the passion of the young people in our country. And they worked hard in 2020 to elect a Democratic House and Senate and presidency. In fact, Republicans, when polled across the country, now believe in the science. That's how effective it has been just since 2010. So we're at the historic turning point right now. The warnings are ever greater from the UN about the dangers, but the solutions are so much more obvious right now. And young people are demanding this change. And so from my perspective, I just think the politics are completely different. It used to be an issue people cared about, but it would be number 18. Now it's up in the top tier, top five issues. And this political system has to respond. Ukraine is warning us of the danger of dependence. The UN is warning us about the climate dangers. The consumers at the pump are being tipped upside down and having money shaken out of their pockets by the oil industry that's engaging in war profiteering. And the historic moment has arrived where we, I think, and I'm optimistic about that, will pass an historic climate energy package this year.
All right.